Hi, welcome to Green TV, the show dedicated to positive Green New Deal solutions and the independent Green and Green Party candidates that advocate for them. I'm your host, Gail for Rail Parker, and I have with me today Pat LaMarche, a Green Party leader, and Emily Heffling with the
Chesapeake Climate Action Network.
Yes, thank you. The independent Greens advocate for jobs, a lot of jobs, solar jobs, wind jobs, weatherization jobs. In fact, there are more people in Virginia that work in solar jobs than there are in coal jobs, some 11,000. Emily, you're the leader, I guess the organizer, for the Chesapeake Climate Action Network. What is the Chesapeake Climate Action Network?
Yeah, so CCAN, which I'll call them, the Chesapeake Climate Action Network, is the oldest, biggest grassroots organization in this region, so Maryland, Virginia, and DC, that focus primarily on fighting global warming. So we're a community-based, action-oriented nonprofit, and we organize people like you two and your neighbors in your own houses, all the way to the state house, to lobby for grassroots policies that can address climate change.
I see. And how long have you been working at this job?
I've been with CCAN for about 2 years now.
2 years, I see. And I understand you had a rally today?
We did.
A successful rally?
It was very successful, yes. We had a rally at ALEC, the American Legislative Exchange Council headquarters over in Arlington. And the ALEC, as we call them, they're a corporate bill mill that write legislation and distribute it to different states that range from anti-clean energy laws to stand your ground laws to other voter ID and voter suppression laws. So we had a big coalition rally today. It was really fun.
And what were you hoping to achieve, and what were your goals with this rally?
So we were rallying today because Dominion Virginia Power, the biggest electric utility in Virginia, is a dues-paying member of ALEC. So essentially what that means is that Virginia's customer bills are funding ALEC. So we were outside demanding that Dominion dump ALEC.
And a lot of for-profit businesses have dumped ALEC.
Yes,
because,
they have.
Because of protests.
Absolutely. Yeah. Microsoft recently.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I see.
And when you think this is something that's using utility payments.
Yeah.
Oh,
I see.
Shame on them.
Virginians are outraged, and we had a big coalition of folks today. About 75 people came out on their lunch hour on a really hot day to join the rally. So we were really happy about it.
Great. Well, the Independent Greens of Virginia connect troops and tax dollars with war for oil. The positive solution, the Greens say, is renewable energy, cutting dependence on fossil fuels. Emily Heffling, please describe the best way to cut dependence on fossil fuels and to go green.
Oh, I'm glad you asked that. The best way to cut our fossil fuel emissions is to transition to 100% clean energy. So we're thinking offshore wind. We have a lot of potential for offshore wind in Virginia. Actually 89,000 megawatts just on our coast, which I know the Green Party, Green TV, talks about jobs, clean energy jobs. Just developing our offshore wind block could provide 10,000 jobs for people. That's safe, clean energy jobs. We also advocate for solar energy, both smaller scale customer-owned solar energy and utility-wide. So utility-owned solar energy, and then energy efficiency has a really important piece in that, too.
I see. I have a friend who has solar energy panels on his home, and the electric company pays him instead of him paying them. So solar energy really works. It makes money. It makes sense.
Absolutely. It does work. unfortunately, in Virginia, Dominion Virginia Power is trying to find ways to limit the ability of customers to have their own solar. So your friend, for example, that's called net metering, where his excess energy can go back to the grid, but it's bought for a very low cost, much lower than it's sold to other customers. So corporations are still raking in a profit from that. And there's also a cap as to how much you can sell back, called a net metering cap. So things that we do at CCAN are trying to change those laws.
I see. Mm-hmm. Well, thank you. It sounds like CCAN and the Independent Greens have a lot in common.
Yeah.
Yeah, the Independent Greens have a full slate of endorsed and nominee candidates this year, and I would like to give them credit at this time. The first one is yours truly. I'm on the ballot in the 1st Congressional District, Gail Farrell Parker. John Smith is on the ballot in the 2nd District. Justin Sedin, the 3rd District candidate. Colonel Albert Burkhart in the 4th. Dr. Ken Hildebrandt in the 5th, and his wife Elaine Hildebrandt is on the ballot in the 6th District. Tariq Salahi is on the 7th. We're going to have a spotlight from him later. Gary Blay is on the ballot in the 8th Congressional District. William Carr is an independent on the ballot in the 9th. Diane Blay, Gary's mother, is on the ballot in the 10th Congressional District. Dr. Joe Galdo is a Green Party candidate on the ballot in the 11th Congressional District. And Janet Murphy is our candidate for U.S. Senate. Ballot Access News reports that there are 27 states that have independent Green and Green Party statewide candidates. Emily, the Chesapeake Climate Action Network is a national organization. And what legislation, you've mentioned some, but what legislation can CCAN advocate at the national and at the local level for Virginia?
Yeah, so CCAN, we're just a regional group, so we don't do a lot of national organizing. But in Virginia, which again, I'm our lead organizer in Virginia, so I know most about that state. But what we're doing right now, one of the big pieces of legislation that we're pushing is expanding the commercial project cap for net metering, like I was talking about before.
Yes.
So right now, commercial businesses in Virginia have to have special permission to have solar arrays bigger than 500 kilowatts. And we want to expand that to 2,000 megawatts. So Dominion Virginia Power, one of the fossil fuel, the biggest fossil fuel emitter in Virginia, recently announced the biggest solar array in Virginia at about 800 kilowatts. And so we're going back and saying, that's because you're limiting the ability of commercial buildings to have more than you. So that's one of the things that we'll be working to change in the General Assembly this year.
I see. Mm-hmm. Very interesting how that
yeah.
works, isn't it? So that's probably why we're not seeing solar farms in Virginia.
Absolutely. Yes. And all signs point to Dominion in the end. They're the biggest non-party donor to our General Assembly members, in addition to being the biggest climate polluter. So they're making a lot of money off of holding Virginians back and keeping us hooked on fossil fuels.
So what you're saying is, in the racket that the politicians have, is that the politicians who take money that Green candidates don't take, all this corporate money, the racket that they have is that when they've hit their max for a donor, that donor can then give to the political party, and the political party dumps the money into their account. And so what you're saying is these two other major political parties that do this dumping of money into their candidates' accounts, they are the tippity-top. And then the very next thing is the local public
exactly.
utility?
Yeah.
That's kind of nasty.
It's yeah. really nasty. Yeah. It's a regulated yeah. monopoly that are yeah. funneling money into our legislators.
We expect the political parties to own their candidates, but when the agenda of a big energy producing, mega yeah. carbon making bad guy owns the rest of the candidate,
pretty scary.
Yeah. Right.
And when you realize how much money plays into politics, you realize how much of a patriot the independent candidates and the Green Party candidates truly are when they're going up against such big money in politics. You know, Howie Hawkins is running for governor in New York, and one of his favorite statistics is that if we build high-speed rail nationwide, it will create 4.9 million jobs. That would add a lot more jobs to the economy, in addition to the eco for the economy jobs that you've been talking about, Emily. We have a lot of projects in Virginia that we would like to advocate for, rail projects. And for the benefit of our viewers, Of course, rail saves lives. It creates jobs. We want to, or the Independent Greens want to expand rail cars on Metro Rail, dedicated new passenger rail tunnel under the Potomac River, high-speed rail and existing right-of-ways along the interstate corridors, dedicated passenger rail track along the Virginia Railway Express, electronic VRE signs that say the next train is, new tracks, more trains, more often. Emily, rail pollutes less. Would you like to see rail provision on? We would like to see a rail provision on your website. Would you be able to add rail to the agenda for CCAN?
So CCAN focuses solely on energy and how fossil fuels, through burning fossil fuels through our energy consumption, is the biggest emitter to climate change worldwide. So that's our specific focus. And I know there are a lot of really wonderful organizations that advocate for rail and better transportation policies in Virginia. So I think that there's a lot of things we need to fight and some organizations that need to fill those niches and those roles. So CCAN's gonna stick with energy for now.
Yeah, with energy, mm-hmm. Okay. Well, of course, we have a lot of the same goals. Mm-hmm. Rail saves energy too. It saves lives. It cuts climate pollution. Rail is a million times safer than automobile travel. Rail pays for itself through economic growth, and every dollar invested in rail creates over $20 in economic benefit to the communities. Rail also enhances our national security. It makes us safer, more secure. It allows for rapid evacuation in this area, which is a real concern. Rail saves tax dollars. Rail makes money. Rail makes sense. Rail everywhere in America benefits everywhere else in America. So what are the most important positive eco-jobs solution for the economy in your view, in CCAN's view?
I think that, as I was saying before, offshore wind provides the biggest opportunity. We have an offshore wind block off the coast of Virginia that has the potential to have 89,000 megawatts of clean energy development. And by developing that, we could really lead the nation in manufacturing and the other supply chain process of developing offshore wind off of our coast, but we're not developing it. So because just the potential of building off of our coast wind turbines, that potential is 10,000 clean energy jobs. So that provides the biggest opportunity for us in Virginia. And again, don't mean to bring up your Dominion Virginia Power again, but they recently purchased that offshore wind block and are just sitting on it. In the next 15 years, they only plan to develop two test turbines of just a little bit more than 200 megawatts because they claim that they need to do more testing to make sure that wind is efficient and makes sense when we see other countries developing wind much more rapidly here. So what we're really hoping and what we're really pushing for is for Dominion to start developing that offshore wind block and provide those thousands of jobs to Virginians.
I see.
It's really very insidious the way all this stuff works. You know, everybody talks about the Chinese, and the Chinese are using a lot of coal. In fact, our coal industry is now exporting more. The Americans are using less, the United Statesians are using less coal than ever, and it's being exported. So people are talking about the Chinese, but they're not talking about the good things the Chinese are doing. You know, it's like, well, if we don't burn coal, the Chinese will just do it, right? That's whatever. If I don't shoot your mother, someone else will. I mean, how does that work? But anyway, so the thing, though, that they have done is they have replaced all their transmission lines. They have new state-of-the-art transmission lines. Over the save 1,200 miles of transmission line in the United States, 1,200 miles of transmission line in China loses 6% of the energy it transmits. Okay, so it gets lost in the wire. You know, it's like waste. It does long the. The United States, the same 1,200 miles, loses 87% of its power.
Wow.
87%. So 80% of the power that we're getting out of all these fossils that we're burning is getting lost in their transmission. It's ridiculous. It's like if you were trying to have a conversation and 87% of the words were missing, you know? Right. But this is power that we have to keep remaking,
yeah,
because we lost it in the transmission of it. But when we had a jobs bill before the U.S. Congress last year they shut the Congress down?
Oh, yes.
Yeah. Well, just before that, they rejected a jobs bill. That jobs bill was to replace those transmission lines. That jobs bill was $21 billion. It would have made more than 100,000 jobs.
Oh.
And the shutdown was $24 billion. The shutdown was more expensive than replacing those lines and saving effectively 81% of the energy that we transmit.
That's why we need more Green Party candidates on
yeah,
the ballot.
Yeah.
We need more people to vote for Green Party candidates.
We do, and we need more green organizations like hers.
We certainly do.
We're a really healthy organizations.
Yes, we are. Pat, would you tell us a little bit of the history of the Green Party? I know
sure.
You know it.
Yeah, well, it's become a relic from it. It started in Germany, the worldwide Green Party, but the U.S. Green Party, the one that we know as the Green Party here, which has a bunch of different affiliates, for example, the Statehood Party in Washington, D.C., right, yeah, is the Washington, D.C. affiliate. But it started in 1984 in Topsom, Maine, at a little church. And what happened was a Mainer had gone up to Canada and gone to a Canadian Green Party meeting and said, you know, this is really the kind of political process we need in the United States. And it's the kind of political process that started the other big parties. It's the kind of political process that gave us Abraham Lincoln, when a new political party needed to be founded because both of the bad parties, the existing parties, supported slavery, right? So you needed something new to do things better. And so four people met at this little church, and they said, we want a Green Party in the United States. And over the last 30 years, it has spread through all the states. It doesn't exist in every state. States like Vermont that have a progressive party, like states like Vermont that gave us Bernie Sanders as an independent. So when you have such a strong progressive base, it's not as easy to build a new progressive party because you basically already have it. So Vermont doesn't have a Green Party necessarily, or if they do, it comes and goes out of existence. New Hampshire is the same way, although New Hampshire has very strong libertarian issues, which libertarians are halfway there. You know, they're anti-war, anti-war entanglements, and pro-responsible adult behavior, you know, civil liberties. So the Greens, as time went by, formed in varying ways, like the Statehood Party, to address their local issues. So the Rainbow Party in Massachusetts, there were all these parties that started up, and the Rainbow Party for civil rights movement. And so eventually we've knitted ourselves together with better and worse success across the country. And our biggest problem is that, I always say the Green Party is so organic and we decompose from time to time. But our biggest problem is that the major parties put such huge obstructions in our way. You know, we can't run political candidates unless you get 65,000 signatures in 75 days in Texas.
Wow.
You know, yeah.
Exactly.
You know, that's a lot of work. Or you have to, in Illinois, you have to run a candidate at every single level. So if you want to run someone for president, you have to run somebody for dog catcher all the way up, or maybe not dog catcher, but the lowest possible, you know, representative all the way straight up through. But still they
make it on the ballot.
They make it on the ballot, and in the Blagojevich election in Chicago and Illinois, where he went to prison, right, for trying to sell President Obama's seat after he vacated it. Mm-hmm. Our candidate, Rich Whitney, got 10% of the vote. 10% in Illinois? Mm-hmm. That's 500,000 votes.
Yeah.
We're not talking little stuff. We're talking really big. Right. And when Rich Whitney ran again 4 years later, I said, your campaign just needs to be, I told you so. Blagojevich is sitting in prison, and I told you so. Yeah. You know, we are the alternative.
Right, exactly.
Yeah.
Okay, well, now let's cut to our Green Party candidate spotlight, which is Tariq Salahi.
Hi, I'm Tariq Salahi, and I'm running for Congress, United States Congressional District 7. I'm asking you to crash the party lines. Don't just look at the D or the R, look at the candidate. Be practical. That's who I am. Look at my back history. I have assisted small business with legislation. I've helped grow jobs in Virginia. I've worked with both parties to pass legislation that's helped you and helped small business in the Commonwealth of Virginia. I'm pro-tourism, pro-agriculture, pro-more businesses coming to Virginia. Bipartisanship is a must. I have a proven record of working with both parties. I'm pro-rail, less traffic. I'm asking you to crash the vote, and that's my website, crashthevote.com or salahiforcongress.com. Please take a look at my Twitter. If you're interested in communicating with me, hashtag crashthevote. I look forward to hearing from you. I look forward to seeing you on the tour, on my listening tour, where I hear your concerns. Thank you for your interest, and please support me. I'm not asking for your money, I'm asking for your vote.
You're watching Green TV. Today, we're interviewing Emily Heffling with the Chesapeake Climate Action Network. And I have here with me, co-hosting, is Pat LaMarche, Green Party leader from Pennsylvania. Welcome to you both, and thank you for being here. Emily, please tell us, you could be doing anything you want. How did you get interested in this line of action, organizing for the Chesapeake Climate Action Network? And where can folks learn more about the Chesapeake Climate Action Network?
Okay, I'm glad you asked. First of all, thank you so much for having me on the show and hosting. People can learn more about CCAN at chesapeakeclimate.org. And it'll list all of our statewide campaigns. We have a lot of really awesome stuff happening on the ground in Maryland and Virginia and DC. Opportunities for people to get involved with big actions like rallies, or smaller actions like calling legislators and lobbying their legislators, or even talking to their neighbors about climate change. So I definitely hope viewers go check us out online at chesapeakeclimate.org. But I was brought to Virginia from Michigan, actually. I'm a Michigan native, and I came here because I got started organizing on my college campus. I went to Michigan State, and I was a political science and philosophy major, and I was really passionate about getting involved in environmental issues. You know, I grew up with such an affinity to nature in the woods of northern Michigan and on Lake Michigan, and once I realized how in danger our natural habitats were, I really wanted to get involved. And the best avenue for change that I thought of at the time was going to law school and holding big corporate polluters accountable through legal mechanisms. And what I realized when I was in school was we have a lot of really talented lawyers, but the laws in place aren't really the best to protect our environment. And so I was in this weird position as a philosophy student, not knowing what to do. And someone petitioned me, so they waved at me and asked me to sign a petition outside of my library on campus, and asked if I could sign a petition to shut down our campus coal-fired power plant. And Michigan State actually has the biggest on-campus coal plant in the country. I had no idea until they gave me a petition and asked me to get involved. From there, they called me and asked me to come to a group meeting, and I've been organizing ever since because it really showed me that the biggest way that we can all affect change is by talking to people, one person to the next person to the next person, and organizing people to be bigger than organized money. So I fell in love with it then and there, and now I get to do it professionally.
I see that. Well, do you have a success story? Is that coal plant still there?
The coal plant is still there, but it's a big fight, and we've come a really long way. The administration nominated a student board to talk about other solutions. Unfortunately, the solutions that they want, like a nuclear plant, aren't the solutions we had in mind, but it's still an incredible opportunity for students to get organized to fight it because we're making waves, and we definitely made a splash on campus. And there's still folks organizing at Michigan State and their Beyond Coal team to shut down that coal plant. So.
Well, I sympathize with you wholeheartedly, and I know how hard a job it is. I've been on the ballot 10 consecutive years now in Virginia advocating for rail. So if a young person out there would like to, you know, has a burning desire to get involved in climate change, what would they need to do? Would they pick up the phone and call you, or?
Yeah, they can find me on Facebook, Emily Heffling, or email me at emily@chesapeakeclimate.org. Super easy email. And my passion as an organizer is finding creative ways to get people involved depending on their resources, their time, their interests, their passions, their skills. So that's really what I love about organizing, because there's a place for everyone to make a difference on any level that they want. So I'd encourage people to reach out.
Yeah, I mean, even if it's just writing a letter, if you sit down, you know, once a month, and you folks, I'm sure, would tell them who to write to. Mm-hmm. Sounds like some of these ALEC-supported candidates might deserve a little mail. And you can hook them up, and then they could never leave their own living room and make a difference.
Absolutely. Yeah. There's ways to get involved at all levels. Really recently, actually, yesterday or the day before, Governor McAuliffe had a press conference with Dominion, Virginia Power, and Duke to announce his support of a massive natural gas pipeline going through Virginia, 550 miles long, 42 inches in diameter, a $5 billion project that is just detrimental to our environment and our climate. So we asked people to make a call to the governor's office and voice their disappointment, and we got a lot of calls in. So it can be as easy as picking up your phone and calling your legislator and saying, you need to fight for clean energy and you need to do it right now.
Okay. Very good point. Thank you very much, Emily, for being here today on Green TV. Emily Heffling, Virginia lead organizer for the Chesapeake Climate Action Network. You can learn more about Chesapeake Climate Action Network at chesapeakeclimate.org. We look forward to hearing more about your campaign success in the future. And thank you, our viewers, for tuning in. And thank you, Pat, for being here. We hope to see you all again in the future for more Independent Green Party candidates. Join us on Green TV again for positive, eco for the environment, Green New Deal solutions. We look forward to hearing your views on Twitter. Tweet us at #VAGreenTV. I'm Gail Farrell Parker. See you again next time.